Hi folks, my trusty Harmex scope died yesterday, so now I need to repair it, and it's the second time I repaired this one, and I repaired another one before, so I know what to expect. I think I know what is the problem, but we shall see and show you the inside of this scope. It's a 350 megahertz Harmex. It's now about six or seven years old. I bought it new back then. I already unscrewed the screws on the back side. That saves some time. You can lift this off, put it away. Hook up wristband. The problem was it did nothing. No LEDs, nothing went on. Everything stayed powerless. This was not the right one because there's a nut behind it. We will do this. This is the power supply, so I have to remove all the screws from that, and then I'll show you the inside. So this is inside the power supply. The scope has been dead before, and then I replaced this diode by a normal 220 version. Zoom a bit in. I can do that. See more details. It's a bit not handy on the camera above, but you see the diode here. So that's a 220. That's a BI. Must see. 229. And the last time that was dead. But at that time I only had this one, and the good diode was not in stock. So now it went dead again, so my first thought will be that the diode is gone again, because it's an 8 amp diode. But on the other hand, I noticed at that time that they use two diodes in parallel, and if they are not exactly the same, one of the two can die. In that case, it will be the first guess that one of those is dead already. Now the power supply is rather good protected, so if the current is becoming too high, it shuts down the whole oscilloscope and nothing gets hot or burns. So that's why I've already opened it. If there's not a single power, but let's now do like we don't know that this has happened, and treat this case as if it is a normal dead oscilloscope, and what we will do to try to repair it. Damn, this is difficult. Okay, I put the power on from my isolation transformer, so now there's 230 volts on the machine, and first I will look if there is a voltage coming into the scope. Probably, yeah, my hand is not in the way. You see, that's 241 volts. We have normally 239 here, but the isolation transformer makes it a bit higher. But okay, so we have a voltage there. This makes 400 volt of 350 volts DC here, and this is the controller chip for that thing. And those often have something that's called sort of idle mode. There are all kinds of names for it: critical conduction mode and offline, and I don't know all the terminology they think of, but that is what they do. Then you see here a big MOSFET, and here the transformer, the controller. How it works is very simple. It's just a buck converter with a transformer. It chops the DC into a sort of square wave, and that feeds it into the transformer. And then if the depending on the state of the configuration, there will be a voltage shot and a current at the other side of the transformer, like you have with a normal classic transformer. If then you here have an optocoupler, the optocoupler, and there is always an extra winding that feeds the controller, so that makes a lower voltage and feeds the controller and wakes it up, and then it starts to tries to start things up. And if that works, there will be power on the secondary side, and here's an optocoupler that tries that looks at the voltage at primary side and if at the secondary side, and if that voltage is like what it should be, that will be measured by the controller, then it's okay, and he starts doing his job and delivers more current or less current by changing his duty cycle and feeds the whole thing. And then all this here is for filtering, and you see a bunch of diodes here, and every diode makes its own rail. It has a filter and it has a filter capacitor, and then here you see more voltage regulators who make the, in this case, the other voltages. There is no schematics from this scope, but Hamech was kind enough to make decent marks on the PCB, so you can see the voltages that are at these points. This should be 5 volt. This should be, I can see it from here. This is 5 volt. This is 3.3 volts, and this one is 18 volts, if I read it correct. But that is the second step. We will see if this one is working. And that we can do by probing here on the primary side, but it is also handy to first measure at the secondary side to see if there is some kind of voltage at that point. Because if there is not, then the thing isn't working at all, so then we know sure. So I take here the chassis ground, it's like here, and then I probe the voltages in DC, of course. Can you see the meter? I must see it too, of course. And that's okay. I didn't know what I did. And then we measure here at the connector. And here I see 0 volts. Here I see 0 volts. And in this one, 0 volts also. So that is definitely not working. I will look up the data sheet, and then I will know more. It looks like that the controller is trying to work, but not getting the work done. So this is the circuit. You see the 230 volts coming in there, and this is the PWM controller, and it has a VCC, that's the second pin, the seventh pin, and that is fed from an extra winding on the transformer. So there will be some current going to the transformer, and that is just enough to make a voltage that will start the controller and keep it running, and then the rest starts to. And the controller is also fed by the high voltage itself on its HV in pole, and that is to chop the voltage and to get it into the transformer. And you see the transformer there, and this is the controller. This is just ground. That is now everything is written next to it. So you see the gate drive, and then the NC, as is the current sense. That is an important part, often not used from the controllers, but if something goes wrong you wish you had it. And the reg with the capacitor on it is the internal voltage regulation, and that is a smoothing cap for it. And the ZC is a zero cross, and that detects when the scope is, when the net is in zero phase, to switch on the converter, so there will not be a big surge. And that is the whole thing. So we're going to measure the pins, the first thing I will do is the VCC, if there is VCC. We already measured that there was a 400 volt, but this is the secondary, this is a separate turning, and then we'll see what is wrong with it and if it's on the primary or on the secondary side. So here, I forgot if I already did that. We'll first check if there is 400 volts or 350 volts. Put it on the ground. That's and the plus, that is 340 volt DC, so that's okay. That is steady, so no problems there. So I changed the setup, and now I've got scope, so you can look with me. I soldered a wire on the minus pole of the bell cap, and I use an isolated differential amplifier, differential probe, for safety. It's now in the 20 times, and this is on 10 times because it cannot do in 20. So some mod is needed. This is pin 2. This is pin 2, and pin 2 is the regulator voltage internal, and it was 2.5 divisions high, so that is 5 volt like we measured with the voltmeter. So that's correct, that's okay. And then there was the VCC, and that should be higher. Not much, but it's something high. And it was pin number 7. And this is 2, this is 7. Will be higher, even more higher. Oh, it's a bit going up and down, up and down, and it can be because it is in some sort of idle mode, going on, because there's the voltage of that is the current of that is coming from this transformer, and it's not really operated right now. So we will look at the gate, and the gate drive is pin number six. It's on this side, but we can I always mix up the numbers if I'm not looking the way that I normally look to it. So the one we had was 7, yeah, that was VC, and that was floating, and then the out is 5, is number 6, so that is 4, 5, 6. Yeah, that's correct, that goes to the gate. Here's the gate, and you see some bursts coming and going, and that is every time it tries to start the oscillator, but there is some reason why he won't do that, and that is also causing the up and down voltage on the pin we measured before, because now there are a lot of pulses. The bell cap in the schematic, the regulator cap is loaded a little bit, and then it stops for a little while, and then it goes down and goes up, it goes down until that it really starts. So that is all working like it should, and there is a reason why it won't start, and maybe we can see something on the pin 3 on the current sense, and that's easy to measure because that is above these resistors, but I think that we need a lot more resolution for that instead of 200 times probe, because I think we are now looking at all the grass instead of the same thing. It starts and it goes, starts. It's not that it doesn't look like there is a large current want to flow, but you never know because you don't know how much over it is. So time to move to the secondary side, and I'll make another setup because I like to probe it on the safe side, and I can kill my phone at the same time. Probably more, it is or the transformer or the diodes. It is a lot more easy to test the diodes because I can test the transformer like you see in other videos, but that is a lot more work than testing the diodes. Now I will first test the diodes that were the problem the last time. So I'll first kill this one. Also has a diode test function I can use. It's not ideal, but it works. Change to meter, and then we choose diode. I first measure the. Always first test your probe, yes. Because otherwise you think it's open. And this gives a volt drop of almost 0 volt, and that is not encouraging. And this one is 0.1 volt. So the first thing comes to my mind is this diode is gone again. And to show you, to be sure, let's look at the other diodes. And you should 0.9 volts. And the other way around, this is the volt drop itself. It's 0.4 volts. That you also see something if you measure the other side is because of all the things that are in parallel and in series. And that's also one of the reasons you should not measure capacitors in circuit. If you measure them circuit and they are dead in circuit, then you can be very sure that it is dead. But if it's measuring well and good, then it still can be bad because there is a good one somewhere in parallel. So I will remove this diode first because the other one is an SMD that's parallel, and if I now measure over it, it must be, if I remember well, it must be parallel on this one, and you see it is 0 volts. And if I flip the probe, that's also 0 volt. So one of those is toast. This diode turns out to be good, and I will now measure again the other one. I can measure it on the same pads, but I will take the other. And it is still 0 volts, so the other one must be short or something else that looks like, but one step at a time. So time to remove the SMD capacitor. That will be a lot of more work because it's embedded between all kind of parts that don't like it when it gets hot there. Maybe you like to see how it is done, because you'll never see the practical side, only the theoretical side of how things are repaired. Often logical, because you can't you are in a very close space. I use two soldering irons for that, and if you have two soldering irons and you they both have glowing tops on it, that are small hollow tops, and they are ideal for SMD work, and they also suck a bit the solder, so you can do very small desoldering things with it. And then I put one on one side of the, and the other on the other side. I think I used the biggest one on the back side because there's a inductor in the way, a lot in the way, and there are caps in the way. I think I need my tweezers. But often this works. Oh, it is a double. Yeah, it's loose. You don't have to be careful that you don't overdo it and keep it too warm. The thing is dead, probably the diode, but you don't want to kill the rest of the transformer. This one is it. It has one common and two on the other side. And also important, if you do this kind of things, if you yank it out like I did now and you did not look or make notes before you did that, then you have to find out what is the right way to mount it again. But now let's test this diode. I will first test it in circuit to see what is happening then. And then we see a volup. There seems to be more parallel in it. That's more down the way and protection stuff. Short as it can be. Yep, it is toast. So, the new diode has survived. The old diode died. So, I will look up some data and see if we can order a new one or if it's still not on stock. And in that case, I think I use two of those because they're only 8 amps, but there's not that much current running there. But the time before I measured it, and this one was a lot cooler than that one. So, but they work like this in this combination for a few months, so it's not that it will go dead by direct. And maybe now the rides are on stock with one of my dealers. So, see you soon. Turns out they are not on stock, and they are expecting them somewhere in January 2018. I'm not going to wait that long, and if I don't get the exact the same ones, I rather place two of those in it. And but now I will match them. I will look if I will select two of them. I've got a lot of them. I will select two that have the same voltage drop at the same current, so they running parallel, and there will be no problem with that. And if they die in the future, okay, maybe the right ones are on stock, and it will be no problem. This is the reverse recovery time you see from the diode I wanted to use in my scope. That is the here you see the pulse, and you see, and that's from the generator. I can show you, this is channel 1. Channel 1 is the generator, and channel 2 is responsive to diode. And the pulse goes from plus 3 volts to minus 5 volts. And at the zero cross, the diode has to block the signal. And it takes a while to do it. He shoots through, and then the PN layers started to come to his old state, where it is blocking the current. And about here it starts to block the current again, and this time is called the reverse recovery time, and that is important for diodes in switching power supplies, because they have to switch very fast. And if it starts to go the other way already here, then the diode is not ready, and then you get very strange results and very hot diodes. Sorry for the sharpness, but my camera does not like this. This is the thing I use for the test. That is it's not very complicated. This is just a generator that makes a pulse, and this goes to the scope for the channel 1 to the voltage over the diode. And this is a termination, 50 ohm terminator, and I measure the current that goes in that 50 ohm, and that goes up to my scope channel 2. And so you see the current, you see the voltage that goes, the diode should block at that point, and in real world it just conducts a while, and it takes some time before it is ready for the next change. So that is what I did. So I'm sure the diodes I can use. This was just a test. The data sheet from this diode says it has a reverse recovery time of 145 nanoseconds. And you see here, I said in my measurement, it is 147 nanoseconds. so very close. And here, the test I do here is to see if both diodes have the same voltage behavior to the current and the forward voltage, because they have to work together. And if one conducts more than the other, that will become more hot, that gets killed, and then the other one goes as well, and that is what happened in my scope, because there were two different diodes. So this is diode 1 and this is diode 2. You see the traces are exact the same. What does the trace say? I don't leave it on for long, because you see here it is 2 amps per division, so the trace goes to there, so it is dissipated. That's 10 amps at that point. So if the thing is conducting 10 amps, then you see the voltage, and it's 2 millivolts per division. That's the V4. We always say that is 0.6 for a normal diodes, and 0.3 or so for Schottky. But see what it is at 10 amps. It is 200 millivolts, so this is 5, that is 9 divisions. Almost 9 divisions, so that is 1.8 volts, and that's a totally different thing as the value stated in data sheets for non-loading situations. And then you think, oh, it's only 0.4 volts, that's great, because I have no more headroom, and that is a nice value, until you use that diode at 10 amps, and then you see what it does with the voltage, and it's not good. So the diode is replaced, and now wait for the big step. We'll put this one here on the minus rail, so we can check voltages if things did not work, and also if they work, because want to know sure that everything is okay. Turn it on. Hey, that's a good sign. Yes, it seems to work again. I'll take my thermometer and see what the diodes do in that place. I just take a reading now, because they're not warm yet, but they are. If I don't point at the white side, at the black side, then the reading is a bit off, so I know if that they really become hotter, or just some reflections. Check the, if I put it like this, you can see it. We have the voltage rails here. This one is the most important, and that is, put my meter in here. Just take this one. It is big enough to read, I think. A bit so you don't shimmer too much. And then I have to make an earth connection. My hands in the live circuits is not my idea of fun. This one is the meter, yeah, DCV, that's correct. 5.7 volts, that seems close. 3.3, that's also correct with what's on the silk screen. Now we here have a minus 6 volt. Yep, this should be a 12 volt, minus 12. Yeah, that's also correct. And I think we have an all taste. It's 3.3. Here's nothing. That's just an in-between voltage, I think. And there is 18 volts, I think. Yeah, 18.888. That's also what's on the silkscreen. 18 volt 882. That's rather correct. Yeah, I need another meter if I want to do that better, but there are no adjustment points, so there's no point in trying to get that. Now I've got all the voltages. Now there might be a reason why the diodes go, and often it is because the ripple is too high, and because capacitors are going short and you have too high a ripple. But that is easy to measure with an oscilloscope. And we have one here. It's an isolated scope, so it is safe to measure direct into the high voltage sites, but I never take chances and I rather use my isolation probe and an isolation transformer, three times safe. This one is the biggest one, and we have to have it in normal scope menu. What do we have here? Normally for the ripple you put it in AC and you look very close at the ripple. But if there is a real problem, we would have seen it also. It's AC, so I can take some smaller scale. And then we added 5 volts here. Not nothing, just grass. Yeah, the same thing. Don't must bend the probe. The 3.3, that was dead. Then we have the negative one. That's also okay. And here was the other negative one. Also no problem. So all seems to be good. The only thing I'm gonna do, but it is not very interesting to see, is removing the PCB and checking all the solderings, because from this side, if I use my magnifiers to look at the soldering joints, two of them don't look that very well, and that can be a cause of killing diodes, because then if the soldering makes bad contact and then makes a good one, the coil can kick back, and of course this is what it always do when it's working, but sometimes in just other ways as the components like. So that will be my last thing, and then it will be I will make it close and do some performance tests. So I took it out the lazy way, and that way I can I only removed the net entrance, and all the other wires are still connected, but because of that I was able to just flip over the whole PCB, and I don't have to deconnect all the connectors. Not that that is very much work, but why do it if it isn't necessary? So I will I just desolder them. It seems well from this side, and they're made placed in VR, so that must be good on the other side too. Like here I see something I don't like. It's not hanging loose. You find soldering balls of tin balls inside the apparatus, and then if they come loose, they're going to short something out if you are unlucky. But this all looks good, so I will retouch them a bit, and then I will close it up and I do some more tests. Don't know what went wrong. I will see, because the camera just stopped. Don't know what it has captured and what not, but I've tested the bell capacitor to be sure, because I thought there was a bit of leakage under it, and now I want to place it back, but there's still a bit solder in the hole, so I have to change tips. If you have to desolder things, and with a desoldering or a wick or whatever, and you have troubles getting it getting the part out, then never go and press hard on the on the pads, because that is the way you make the glue soft and they laminate, and then you are in bigger problems. Always use some flux, and if your soldering iron isn't beefy enough, add some solder. Try to melt some solder on the tip of your iron and then hold it to the position, so there is a bigger bridge to let the warmth flow into the pad without putting pressure on it, and then then it will come loose. And don't do it too long. You don't want to cook your PCB. That will go, and if pads are loosing, and then it's the beginning of the end and you have all sorts of problems. So always be careful. Sometimes it's possible to first cut some legs from a component. Then that is a better way to do it. The pads on the underside and the upper side are connected together through vias, and if you have multi-layer boards, there also are traces inside the PCB connected to that. So if you yank a part out of it and you see the pad and a piece of the via still connected to the pin of the component, and it is a multi-layer board, then cross your fingers, but there is a big chance that you have done some very big damage and you have to grind away all of the PCB, rebuild the NLI layers, rebuild the PCB itself and all the pads in and on top of it. And it is a lot of work if you can do it. I've done that several times, but it is not easy and it is a lot of work. It is not very difficult, but you have to have the guts to do it, because the things you have to do are irreversible. If you cut a hole in it, you are the one that has to close it again, and you have to know how and do it. So this one is clean again. I will remove the flux from this one and from that one. It is non-clean flux, but I don't like all the flux residues on the boards. I want to have them clean. A bit more there. Some EPA for the second gas. The first time is PCB cleaner. The next time is EPA. That's alcohol. Very pure alcohol. And that makes it better clean. And this soldering I don't like at all. It is good, but it is just to be sure. I'm lazy now. Normally I suck away the old solder, especially when it's lead free, but okay, it's my own scope. So I have a problem if it goes bad again. I only can complain to myself. A lot of portable gear often has soldering joint problems. This one is not portable, so, and it's not old, and it's a quality piece of equipment. It's not some Chinese crap. I see here some flux. There's the shadow. Yep. So screws back in and ready. So as a last test, 500 picoseconds pulse, and he captures it well. Also tried the function generator, and that also worked on both channels. So I'm happy he is working again. Thanks for watching, and until the next video. Bye bye.